It's springtime and flowers are blooming, and they're all calling pollinators to come and visit. But what exactly do flowers do? What is the purpose of a flower? Stick around and you might find out.
Hi, and welcome to the Lawrence at Home. My name is Bia, and I'm one of the teachers at the Lawrence Hall of Science. In today's video, we're going to be learning about how well adapted are flowers and their pollinators. Before we get started with today's investigation, make sure to hit that subscribe button and give this video a like so you never miss a cool science video like this one. In part one, we're going to be exploring the relationship between flowers and pollinators, and I'm going to show you how to do a flower dissection you can try at home. But for now, let's begin today's investigation by going outside to observe some flowers. I'll see you soon! Well, today, I'm going to take you on a walk through my neighborhood, and we're going to explore a little bit what different flowers we can find.
Before leaving the house, I put on my mask and then began searching for flowers. I was able to find many flowers of different colors, shapes, sizes, and quantities, and was astounded by the huge variety I could find. Later, I did some research and found out that scientists estimate that there are over 300,000 different species of flowering plants, or as they are also called, angiosperms. That is about 80% of all plant species on the planet. But another thing that I noticed on my walk is that wherever I found flowers, I was also very likely to find animals visiting those flowers. These animals are called pollinators.
So before we get into detail about what pollinators do, let's take a look at the anatomy of a flower. That way, it will be easier to understand the pollinator's job.
For today's activity, we'll be doing a flower dissection, which means to separate and identify its parts. The flower I'll be using is this type of Peruvian lily. I really recommend lilies or daffodils for this activity, but other flowers might work as well, although their structures might be a lot harder to identify. Make sure that you have permission to pick the flower that you choose. So first, I removed the little leaf that was attached to the stem and began by identifying the petals and seeing where they were connecting. Being very careful not to damage the other parts, I began to remove the petals one by one. On this flower, I counted 6 petals in total. 3 of them were bigger with a lavender color and pink edges, and the other 3 were smaller with brown spots in a white and yellow background. Next, I studied the parts that were left and noticed that among these wiggly bits with this brown rice-shaped structure on top, there was one shorter tube with nothing on top. At this point, I also noticed a little bug friend that wanted to be a part of the video, but the camera didn't focus on it. So I began to remove the longer bits and counted 6 of them. Then I was left with the bottom part of the flower from where the shorter tube was sticking out of, and it looked like it was connected to something inside. Now that I had all my flower parts separated, it's time for my favorite part, labeling. I started by labeling the 6 petals. Then it was time for my next structure, that is made up of the anther on top where the pollen is located, and the filament that holds up the anther. These two structures together make up the stamen. Then I moved on to the last structure. The very tippy top of this shorter tube is called the stigma. The long part of the tube is called the style, and inside of the base of the flower is where the ovary is located. The structure altogether is called the pistil. I hope that you also get to try this activity at home. If you do, you can ask an adult to take a picture of your labeled parts and share with us on Instagram, tagging us at Berkeley Science. In order for a flower to produce the fruit that contains the seeds that can grow into a new plant, pollen has to be transported from the anther of a flower in one plant to the stigma of a flower of the same kind in another plant. And this process is called pollination.
A pollinator's job is to transport pollen from one flower to the next. Once a flower is pollinated, it will then form fruits that contain the seeds that can give rise to other plants. But pollinators don't do that just purely out of kindness. They also depend on the plants to survive. They often feed on the nectar for their own energy.
Nectar is a sugary liquid produced by the flower that attracts their pollinators to come and visit. While collecting the nectar, Some of the pollen gets stuck to the pollinator's body and ends up being transported when they visit multiple flowers.
So flowers and pollinators have what scientists call a symbiotic relationship. Sym meaning together and biotic referring to life. So they are essentially living together by helping each other. Wow, that was so interesting. So today we learned that there's a huge variety in flowering plants and that these plants depend on pollinators to make new plants, while pollinators depend on the plants for food. I hope that you get to try out our flower dissecting activity at home. Thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to subscribe and give this video a like, and I'll see you soon for part 2, where we'll explore how flowers attract their pollinators, design a pollinator of our own, and learn more about bees from our friends at Planet Bee. Thank you so much for watching. Once again, my name is Bia, and I'll see you next time at the Lawrence at Home.